Good morning. How are you this morning? Maybe more appropriately, how are your backs this morning? Hey, Emmanuel, are you working hard? Are you shoveling hard? Yeah? Yeah, it's Communion Sunday. Make sure you're telling the truth. Yeah, no, it's great to see you here this morning. We weren't sure what you'd be like if people, we heard one story of somebody who got picked up by another member in the church to get here because of the snowplow windrow at the end of the driveway. They couldn't get through it, so that's great for God's people to be helping each other out. Wow. Great to see you here together with us in the house of the Lord this morning. For those who are joining online, thank you for joining us online as well. Just a couple of announcements I'd like to bring your way this morning as we begin our time of worship. The first is that it is the Lord's table this morning. So if you have not received your elements yet, just raise your hand and our ushers will come and bring the elements to you. So right now, if you do not have the elements, just put your hand up. And those of you who are at home, make sure that you have the elements that you can participate with us as well. There's a question, there's a couple of inserts in the bulletin that we want to draw your attention to this morning. The first is a service time survey. And it's a small little card in your bulletin. We had a request to see whether we want to continue to have, yes, thank you, Paul. Paul's holding it up. There's a request that has been made whether we want to continue meeting at 10 o'clock or to adjust the times of service. So if you'd just do us a great favor, because we would like to get feedback from you, just take a few minutes to fill out that card, and there's a big red box on the table out in the foyer. Just drop it in on your way out today. Also, there is a small group survey as well in their bulletin this morning. As you know, Pastor John and I would like to see more small groups develop shortly after Easter, about an 8 to 10 week focal point. And so if you would like to be part of a small group or would like to be maybe even a leader of a small group, please contact us by filling out that survey and passing it on to either Pastor John or myself. Today is Name Tag Sunday. Everybody has name tag on, I think I can see. That's great. This is an opportunity to get us to be more familiar with each other. We have a number of new people, and also through the last couple of years, it hasn't been easy to connect with each other as much, so we want to encourage you to take some time today just to say hello to the people, and at least you'll know their name, because you can look down first before you look up in their face. We're also having Soup Sunday as well today, and part of Soup Sunday is a fellowship time in the Foundation Hall following the service, so please join us for a part of that fellowship time so you can get to know each other even better over some nice soups. Also want to let you know just that in the out on the table as well, there's our phone book. We're trying to finalize it. This might be the last Sunday that we have it out there for any additions that you might have, so please take your time today to look and make sure your information is correct, change it, whatever is necessary. You put a check mark or your initial beside it if everything is fine. And then we will get new phone books published for people in the congregation to have. There's a few other announcements on the bulletin, but I just want to highlight those ones this morning. We do want to come on this Communion Sunday recognizing the significance of a promise from God. And it's a one-verse promise out of Matthew chapter 18, verse 20, where it says, "Where two or three come together in my name, there am I with them." And that's a wonderful promise to know that if we are coming together today in the Lord's name, and that doesn't mean with our own agenda and our own ideas, it means we're coming to honor and worship Him. Today on this Communion Sunday, we're coming to recognize His faithfulness to us while we were sinners, that Christ died for our sins. If we come in His name, then He promises He will be with us. What a great opportunity for us to just pause this morning and thank the Lord for His presence. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank You, God, for this family that You have created here at Harmony. And I pray, Heavenly Father, that You will bless our time of worship of You today. Lord, guide our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Help us to focus, Lord, on who You are, Your unfailing love, Your sacrifice, Your beauty. Help us, God, to be thankful to You, for You alone are God. And we are blessed to know that You will join us, Lord. Your very presence can be here this morning, Lord, if we come acknowledging who You are and what You have done. Lord, we invite You today to lead us into worshiping You. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Worship team.
Well, good morning, everyone. So great to see all of you out this morning after that big snowstorm. So we've got a good representation here. Isn't it great to be in the house of the Lord? This is the day that the Lord has made. This is the day when he can be found, God of all, breath of life, living water, Savior, friend. Come as the hungry, feed on his word. Come as the thirsty, drink of his love. Come as the faithful, let us worship the Lord. Bless the singing of your praises, the sharing of our fellowship, the reading of your word, the message that Pastor John will share, and the prayers that will be heard. Please stand. Because we're going to sing the family of God, why not greet the person right next to you? Now you all have name tags, you know everybody's name, so just greet the person next to you. Be seated.
White as snow.
Without the blood of Jesus Christ, there wouldn't be a church. So the last hymn we're going to sing at this moment is The Church's One Foundation. Let us pray. We are gathered here today, Lord, as your people to offer you our sacrifice of prayer and worship. Some of us have walked with you for many years. Others are just starting their journey. Some are strong, others are weak. Some are full of joy, and others are burdened with care and grief. You love us all in equal measure. Dear God, open our ears and our eyes to see your vision for this place and our part within it. Teach us, hear our prayers, and enable us for service wherever you might take us, to your praise and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. John chapter 6, verse 51 states, I am the living bread that came down out of heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he shall live forever. Did you know that the ultimate soul food is the bread of life? All our favorite foods are often referred to as soul food. And as good as that sounds, only the bread of life provides lasting satisfaction and contentment. Jesus tells us that he is the bread of life, the ultimate soul food, because only he provides us with spiritual nourishment that lasts. By dying on the cross, Christ wanted us to know that he is the bread of life, the only food that brings contentment and fulfillment to our souls. This song is appropriately called Bread of Life.
Thank you, Louise and Linda, for leading us in that song of preparation. Jesus is the bread of life. There is no substitute. He is the provision of God for our sins. He is the one who died on the cross and took our sins and the sins of the whole world upon his shoulders. Nobody else could do that except the perfect Lamb of God, Jesus Christ. We are here today to thank God for his amazing sacrifice through Jesus Christ. Why God would do this for us is beyond thinking when we think about it, when we reflect on it. But God did, out of his profound love for each one of us. He calls us to come to the table, not just as a tradition, but he calls us to come to the table to draw closer to God himself, to become more sacrificial in the way we live, to become more loving in the way we live, to be more forgiving in the way that we live, to recognize Jesus Christ and all he has done in securing our salvation if we believe in his name and call upon him. This invitation is out for all of us today, for those who are online, those who are here in person. It's a time to accept Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord. And maybe some of you have done that like 30, 40, 50 years ago. But it's always an opportunity to reflect and to examine ourselves. In fact, Corinthians, I'll be reading from 1 Corinthians 11, right after the normal Lord's table words comes these words: a person ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink of the cup. Because anyone who eats of the bread and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on themselves. So there's a call for us all to come before the Lord and to examine, how are we? Are we in a right relationship? Are we living rightly for the Lord? Is there a need for us to come before the Lord asking for forgiveness, to renew our commitment to Him? Is there an opportunity just in the beauty and the love of who God is, an opportunity for us just to sit back and look at Him and think about how wonderful the love of God is for each one of us? This is why we gather around the table. These are the words that were recorded in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 that we reflect on this morning, and we pause before we give thanks. The Lord Jesus, on the night that He was betrayed, He took bread, and when He had given thanks, He broke it and said, "This is My body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of Me." And in the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in My blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of Me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes again." And He is coming again. Let's pause and give thanks to the Lord. Heavenly Father, we ask right now, Lord, that in the quietness of our hearts, we would just pause for a moment, examining ourselves, reflecting on Your love for us, which is so deep and so profound, so endless. We pray, Heavenly Father, that You will forgive us for the sins that we've committed, those we committed knowing and even those we've committed not knowing. We pray, God, this morning and ask that You would give us a heart that is soft towards You and reaches out into this world with the love of Jesus Christ. We thank You, God, this morning for Your Son, Jesus Christ, who even though He was facing torment and torture on the cross, carrying the sins of all people, the burden of the sin was not for Him to bear, yet He bore our sin and the burden of our sin. God, we thank You that He was willing to suffer and die for us in our place. We thank You for the Lamb of God, the perfect, pure Jesus Christ, who is enough and more than enough to pay for all sins of all time. We thank You for this perfect sacrifice on our behalf. Heavenly Father, we thank You this morning for these two elements, the bread representing Jesus' body, representing the provision, God, that You gave for our sins. And Lord, the cup representing the blood of Jesus Christ, which was spilled on the cross all over the place, Lord, but acknowledging that the blood was sufficient for the atonement of sins for all time. God, we praise You for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And Lord, may not be just a moment in a service, Lord, but may this be a dedication of our lives to You and Your purpose that we see in Jesus Christ. Create us, God, to be more like Him through participating in the Lord's table this morning. God, may He be seen in us as we live out our days. And we give You thanks and praise for Your love and for Your glory. In His name, amen. I invite you to take the bread in your hands. And after Jesus had given thanks, He took the bread, He broke it, and He gave it to His disciples. Let's eat together in remembrance of Him. And after supper, Jesus took the cup of redemption, and recognizing that this was a symbol of the redeeming love of God. Let us drink it together in remembrance of him. O gracious and loving Father, we thank you for the forgiveness of sins through your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you, God, that we can live joyfully in your presence, that we can follow your word and your living word, Jesus Christ. We can, Lord, know the Holy Spirit that dwells in us will guide us in the way we can reflect your light in this world. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for our eternal destination is in your hands. Lord, the glory of heaven awaits all who call on your name. Father, we thank you and praise you this morning for your love that motivates us to live beyond our ability. God, thank you. Thank you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to invite Steve to come on up and lead us in our time of worship this morning, a time of prayer this morning.
As a song said that we sang earlier today, we are a family, and God asks us, actually, he directs us to pray for our family members, for each and every one, and not just for those that are here, but for the extended family, to other churches around the world. So would you gather with me and pray? Dear Lord Father, you are so amazing and glorious. We are so thankful for everything that you do for us. Lord, we pray for all the churches, all our brothers and sisters, all those gathered here, and those around the world that are gathering to worship you. We are so thankful that we can gather and worship you. And we pray for those ministries that are out there trying to reach new people, people that are lost, the people that we love and people that you love. Lord, we think of those that are on the front lines that we are partnered with, the Pregnancy Help Center, Gate 316, Hope Awaits, The Refuge, and many more in this area. Lord, please be with them as they reach out and spread your word and your love to the communities around them. Lord, we also have many people in this congregation who are suffering from different trials, illnesses, and different difficulties. Lord, we thank you for those difficulties, because it's through those difficulties that we grow, that we develop perseverance and trust in you. We learn to rely solely on you. And we also learn through our times that when we come through it and are healed or the situation is resolved, we learn to give glory to you. It's the only way we can make it through. Lord, we pray specifically for those with cancer, like through Faith, Morgan, Linda, and others that we know in extended family that aren't part of our church family here. Lord, we also pray specifically for unsaved loved ones, whether they be children or parents, spouse, or just extended family, or even our neighbors. We ask that you reach out and use us to show your love and your light to them. Lord, we also pray for upcoming surgeries and illnesses. We pray for specifically for Will Grosset, because he's here recovering from appendix surgery last week. Lord, we thank you for Will and his willingness to serve, and we thank you for your healing touch on his life. Lord, we also are so grateful when new life comes into this world. Lord, I'm thinking specifically of Dave's daughter, Alicia, and her husband, Rashida, who are going to be having a baby on Tuesday. The baby, there'll be an induction. The baby's name is Naomi. And we ask for a safe delivery, both for the mother and for the child. And we ask that Dave and Lori can be a beacon of light in little Naomi's life to lead her to you. Lord, in many places in the world, there are different forms of destructions, earthquakes, droughts, tornadoes. There are wars. You have told us that these will happen to the end. But we still pray for those that are affected by them, that you comfort them. Give them comfort in their time of grief over lost loved ones, destruction of their property. And we ask for safety for them and that your word spreads in those areas. And mostly we pray, come Lord, come soon. Lord, we also pray for our political leaders as they guide the countries. Be with them. We don't always agree with them, but we know you have put them in place and it is your will that they're there. So we ask that you guide them, give us peace as they make decisions, whether we agree with it or not, and help us to respect the office that they represent and the person who put them in office, which is you. Lord, again, we praise you for everything that you're doing in our lives. And we ask that you be with us each personally and draw us closer to you. I ask this in the blessed name of Jesus. Amen.
Actually, I'd like to just pause for a moment and just give thanks for the offering, if we could. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much, God, that you are the God of generosity. You're so generous with us, Lord. And while we are undeserving, Lord, you have lavished every perfect and good thing that comes from the Father, comes from you, God. We thank you. And we pray, Heavenly Father, you'll bless these gifts, these offerings. Lord, that you use them to accomplish your kingdom's purpose. Help us, God, with wisdom to know what will honor your name. We thank you for the generosity of the givers, Lord. May blessing flow upon our people as we continue to support your work here in this world. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right. Well, thank you. I feel like I got a little bit ambushed there. All right. Freeze, we're praying now. Anyway, but no, it's always good. More prayer is always good. And, you know, we just wanted to center out the offering as something that's not something that's secondary, but just a reminder that we are supported by your generosity and keeping the lights on, keeping us, keeping the church running. So. But this morning, sharing the word with you, we're going to Matthew 16, if you want to turn there. Matthew 16, verses 13 to 19 is the text that I've chosen. And so we're looking at, overall, it's a new series that looking at is, what is the church? And, you know, this is a kind of important question, as we have a committee right now reworking the bylaws, writing, well, basically the rules for our church. And, well, it's important to know what is the church in general. And so we've been looking at Scripture and how it's our foundation as believers, and been even last week looking at the spiritual war that we're in and different things that come up, and how it's actually a fight that we're in the midst of. And yet here we come to the church's one foundation. And so it was good to sing that song that I hadn't at least been brought to my mind, the church's one foundation. And so it's good to hear that one. But so we're looking in the text here in Matthew 16, verses 13 to 19, and trying to put to rest some of the false views of what is our church's foundation and what truly is the foundation of this church. So I'm going to read the text for us. Matthew 16, verse 13. I'm in the English Standard Version. Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they say, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter replied, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." Then he strictly charged the disciples to tell no one that he was the Christ. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you that you've given us your word, that you have revealed to us even that you are the Christ. I pray that you'd be working in us to help us to understand what this means. And I pray that it would be your words in my mouth. Send your spirit, Lord, that it would give understanding to the hearer and words in my mouth. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So when we coming to this text, I just broke it down. I only have 2 points, but multiple sub-points in them. Now, the first one is that the church recognizes Jesus as he is. And so we recognize Jesus as he is. This is in verse 13 and 14, we come to different views of who the people at the time thought that Jesus was. And so Jesus is asking his disciples, "Who do people say that I am? Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And so for one, he starts by identifying himself as the Son of Man. But the people are there going, "Oh, well, they think you're John the Baptist. We think that you're Elijah or Jeremiah or one of the other prophets." And yet, elsewhere is the same kind of thing. "Oh, you might be Elijah. Oh, you might be Isaiah. You might be the prophet," but very few are there to call him the Christ. And so the world is there talking about who he might be. Who is this Jesus? And it's no less different today that people come up with different views of who Jesus is. "Oh, well, he might be some form of prophet." You look at Islam and their explanation, they say that he was a prophet. They say that he was sent by God, but yet he was not necessarily the Christ. He was just someone there for the Jews and the Christians, and yet he didn't die on the cross in Islam either, according to the Quran. So they talk about him, and they give him some priority, but it's not what we would see, not what we believe the Bible is teaching us. And so they're talking about Jesus. And the common view today is that he was some kind of moral teacher way back then, that if you asked a secular person, they'd probably say, he existed. But there was nothing special about him. He was just another teacher. He's another one of those Jewish rabbis that actually had better teaching than the rest, which is why we've kind of preserved his teaching. And so they like to talk about him. And so yet they don't really want to identify him as the Christ. They don't want to identify him as their Lord and Savior. And yet this is just causes more confusion to us as we come to try and understand who is Jesus. As the church, we need to recognize Jesus as he is, not just what people say about him. I know it's the same thing, we can talk about other people. And, I'm sure if I were to ask someone else in the church, someone from this side, what somebody on this side is like, they get a different explanation. But the best way to actually know someone is ask them, "What are you like? Not what does, don't ask me what I think about Justin Trudeau. Go ask Justin Trudeau about himself. I'll give a very different answer than he'd give about himself. And so it's the same kind of thing here. People are talking about Jesus. People are still talking about Jesus. And just from a worldly perspective, is honestly the most amazing thing, is that somebody who didn't write anything himself, only his disciples wrote about him, who didn't own anything, who didn't lead any armies, who didn't rule over any piece of land, and yet he is still the most talked about person who ever lived. And it should perk up your ears, even if you don't know who Jesus is maybe I should find out. And maybe I should find out from those who knew him and actually those who recorded what he said. And so here we come and people are talking all about Jesus. They've been seeing him doing miracles. They've been seeing him doing all kinds of things. And they're saying, you know, maybe he's a prophet or somebody sent from God. And yet then he asked his disciples, those who are closest to him, these are the ones that you would expect to know him the best. And this is Peter's response. Simon Peter replied, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And so here, Peter recognizes him for who he truly is. He says, yes, you know, lots of people are talking about you. Lots of people say you're the Christ. And yet, here, recognizing you are the Christ, you're not just a prophet. And really, that's our place. That's where we need to find ourselves. And that is what is the foundation, ultimately, of our church here is recognizing Jesus as he is. And so here, that recognition, as the world talks about Jesus, and as we recognize Jesus as he is, Jesus answers Simon, and he says in verse 17, "Blessed are you, Simon Barjona." And so this recognition, merely recognizing Jesus as he actually is a blessing. It says, "Blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you." And just a brief mention, Simon Barjona is Simon, son of Jonah, or son of John, depending on the translation. But it is just to recognize it's you, Simon. But it's Simon Barjona, "Flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven." And so even to recognize who Jesus is not a mere matter of physical, it's not a mere matter of intellectual power, but it's a revelation from God. That God blesses us, even that we might recognize who Jesus is. And even John in his gospel says, in order to see the kingdom of heaven, you must be born again. Even to see it. Because, we look around and we're so stuck in physical terms. We're so stuck in what's going on around us that we'd have something to feel, something to touch. That we would see more and more people, and we want a physical kingdom and we want a king that's sitting here. And I would love that Jesus and his kingdom would be here present on this earth. And my heart goes towards that as well. But I have to recognize what has been revealed to us. Is that here Jesus elsewhere says, "My kingdom is not of this world." And yet, to fully understand what that is a whole nother sermon. But here we're recognizing Jesus, and that comes to us from God. And just as Peter had that revealed to him from God, we have it revealed to us from God, that we would recognize who Jesus truly is. And this is a blessing towards us. Because elsewhere it's, how might I be saved? That those, as they're proclaiming the gospel, "Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved." And elsewhere that it says, "Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." Who is the Lord? Who's the Lord strong in battle? Well, it is the Lord Jesus Christ. It is if you believe in your heart that Jesus died for your sins, and if you confess with your mouth that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. And this way of salvation is so simple, and yet it's a blessing that comes from God that we might truly know it within our hearts. That is going from that intellectual assent, that we see it outwardly, that we examine this evidence and we go, yeah, okay, these people might be saying lots of different things about Jesus, but then his disciples, and when we look into what it is that we can actually know about him, we come to this conclusion, he is the Christ, and yet to truly believe that, we need God to work in our hearts. We need God to work in us. And ultimately, that's our prayer. And yet the command even that I want to give you is believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved. And that it's not a matter of waiting and seeking and wanting, okay, God, just work in my heart and then I'll believe. But he says the word is before you today. And it is not far from you, but it is in your very heart and in your very mouth. Confess that the Lord Jesus Christ has risen from the dead. Believe in him for the forgiveness of your sins, and you shall be saved. And so here, this is our foundation. Our foundation and given to us from God. So here, we recognize recognizing Jesus is a blessing from God. And yet here, when we come back to the church, we come back to what Simon has said, and he says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And that's the foundation of this church. The church confesses Jesus Christ is Lord. And so anywhere you see that Jesus Christ is Lord being confessed truly from the heart and truly according to the word, that's where the church of God is. And now, I do want to make two things that are, or at least two distinctions here in the church. We have the church invisible and the church visible. So the church invisible is that which is all of the believers, all those who have truly believed in the Lord Jesus Christ. That Christ has one church, one bride, one body, made up of all of the redeemed from all time, gathered together in the great congregation in heaven, waiting for his return, and yet here present still today, existing, is those who are truly believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. No matter what condition they're in, whether what church physically they're in, if you're truly trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ, you are part of the church of Christ. And yet we have the church visible, that Christ actually tells us to organize ourselves, and throughout the epistles given in the New Testament, that we're organized into a visible church. And here at Harmony Road, we are a visible church of Christ. And yet where the Lord Jesus Christ is confessed, people gather into local congregations, and where the teaching is not twisted by different false teachers and heresies, because there are false churches that claim the name of Jesus Christ, but where Christ is truly preached as he is, there is a visible church of Christ. And so here we recognize Jesus as he is, that we might be a visible church of Christ in Oshawa, shining the light in our community, and yet we're part of the invisible church of Christ, part of all of those who have been redeemed, that we recognize that if you have confessed the Lord Jesus Christ, you are part of the church of Christ. And yet, moving on to the second point, the church is founded on Jesus Christ. This becomes a text that is actually twisted by some. I tell you, that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. This is verse 18. I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. And so this becomes the question, what is this rock? And if you dig around in different teaching all around, people will have different explanations. And so here in the text, Jesus says, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. And in the Greek, it's Petros is Peter. You know, it's not changed that much coming to English, but then rock is Petra. And so it's a slightly different variation of the same root word, both meaning rock. And yet the difference is slight. Petros, meaning a small stone or a stone, whereas rock is, or Petra is foundation, or it is kind of the bedrock. And you see this as, you know, Peter's, or Jesus is laid in a tomb that was hewn out of the rock. And so the image I want to paint for you is that of there was a stone rolled in front of the cave where he was buried, and yet the cave itself is dug out of the rock. The stone, however, how large, is nothing compared to the rock out of which the cave is hewn. And so this is the idea, is Jesus is the rock. And however big or however important Peter may have been as a stone, as a rock, he is not the foundation of the church. Jesus is the rock to which he is referring. I just imagine it went down like this, that Jesus says, you are Peter, you are a stone, and yet on this rock, pointing to himself, Jesus would have been that he is saying, I will build my church. Because the Roman Catholic Church today asserts that Peter has a primacy, Peter has a legacy here in this text, which affirms the supremacy of the church at Rome. I can even read a brief portion of their teaching from their catechism. So it says, the Second Vatican Council's decree on ecumenism explains, for it is through Christ's Catholic Church alone, which is the universal help towards salvation, that the fullness of the means of salvation can be obtained. It was to the Apostolic College alone, of which Peter is the head, that we believe that our Lord entrusted all the blessings of the new covenant in order to establish on earth the one body of Christ, into which all those should be fully incorporated who belong in any way to the people of God. And so here it is asserting Peter has the primacy. The Apostolic College has the foundation. And yet here, you know, they go on that it is particular churches are Catholic through their communion with one of them, and the Church of Rome, which presides in charity. He says, indeed, from the incarnate Word's descent to us, all Christian churches everywhere have held and hold the great church that is here at Rome to be their only basis and foundation, since according to the Savior's promise, the gates of hell have never prevailed against her. And so here we have this claim that unless you are in communion with the church at Rome, you're not the true church, because that is, Peter himself is the foundation, and some along the lines it was passed down to Rome that the bishop of the church at Rome would be the foundation. And yet, I want to bring us back to the scripture and go, okay, I could understand maybe that from coming from this text alone, but yet this is not the only page in my Bible. This is not the only place the rock is mentioned. And yet this is why we need to turn and diligently understand these things, because they're trying to set a different foundation for the church. And so here we recognize the rock. And so I want to turn to Ephesians 2:20. should be familiar to some of you, or Ephesians, I'll read Ephesians 2, 19 and 20 and 21. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God. And so he has three illustrations there already. Citizens with the saints, members of the household of God, and yet built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure being joined together grows into a holy temple in the Lord. And so here, this is Paul writing and saying, well, here, Christ is the cornerstone. Christ is that foundation stone. And then elsewhere, if you want to turn to 1 Peter, 1 Peter chapter 2, it's after Paul's letters, there's James, and then there's 1 Peter, or coming backwards from Revelation, you've got to go past John's epistles to 1 Peter chapter 2. Here's what Peter says about this. So 1 Peter 2 verse 4, as you come to him, a living stone rejected by men in the sight of God, chosen and precious. So as you come to him, Jesus Christ, you yourselves, like living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. And then he goes on to quote Scripture. For it stands in Scripture, behold, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone, chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. So here it's a stone, and whoever believes in that stone shall not be put to shame. In verse 7, so the honor is for you who believe, but for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone, and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. And so here we have the stone that is Jesus Christ, the foundation of our belief, the foundation of our church, the only sure foundation. Now I could go on in the New Testament mentioning the foundation, but also turning into the Old Testament, that who is called the rock? What first came to mind to me is Psalm 18. And so Psalm 18 starts like this. I love you, Lord, O my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer. My God, my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. In verse 3, I will call upon the Lord who is worthy to be praised, and I am saved from my enemies. It's a somewhat familiar song that I like. And the next verse actually comes from verse 46 in this same song. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. The Lord is my rock and my salvation. Verse 31 here in Psalm 18, not even going anywhere yet. For who is God but the Lord? And who is a rock except our God? Now, how much of a sure foundation is the one who is both Son of Man and Son of God, who is God himself in the flesh, than a man, no matter how good, appointed by God? And so here, Jesus is the rock. Peter is recognizing Jesus as the rock. And really, that's why he is so blessed, is that he is blessed because he's recognizing who Jesus is. And I even wrote down a few more psalms where it's mentioned that God is our rock. Psalm 28, verse 1, 31, verses 2 and 3, 42, verse 9, 62, verses 2 and 6, and 71, verse 3, 78, 35, 89, 26, and 92, 15, and then I just stopped writing them down. But here, God is our rock and our, he is our foundation. He is the one who has given us salvation, the sure place on which we stand. And so it's not on merely a man, but it is on the one who is both God and man. And so here we have this competition of, is Peter the rock? Is Peter a sure place to stand? And really, just one more point, since it's right here in verse, if we're going to go back to Matthew 16, our text. So Matthew 16 and just verse 21, you go to, here's the next thing that we learn about Peter. So from that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, "Far be it from you, Lord, this shall never happen to you." But he turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a hindrance to me, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man." So here, Peter, who is recognizing Jesus as the rock and the foundation, as soon as Jesus teaches something that Peter really doesn't understand at the time, he's then trying to rebuke Jesus, which, I don't know, is just doesn't make any sense in my mind, is you're recognizing who Jesus is as the Christ, and then you're in the next breath, you're trying to rebuke him for his teaching that he has to go to Jerusalem and die. And yet Jesus rebukes Satan, or rebukes Peter and calls him Satan. And he says, "Get behind me, Satan." Now, really, that's not much of a sure foundation in my mind, and I don't know if that's put right after this confession just to give us an idea of the fact that it's not Peter, but it's Jesus himself. And yet, Peter is indeed one who is restored, even as he falls away and denies Jesus Christ, that we have that same sure foundation, that Jesus restores us, even when we turn away, even when we turn away from his teaching, and even when we, even in ignorance, ignore some of it. And so here, Jesus is the rock, the sure foundation of this church. And so here, Jesus is the rock, and going to verse 18, Jesus builds the church. Just continuing on there. "I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church." And so Jesus is the one that builds his church. And as I mentioned earlier, the invisible church versus the visible church, that here we have Jesus Christ building up a people for himself from every tribe, from every tongue, from every nation. And yet he is also building and encouraging and growing invisible congregations. And so it is, first of all, his church. He says, "I will build my church." And oddly enough, only here and in Matthew 18 is the word church used in all of the Gospels. Church is used frequently throughout the epistles, throughout all the letters of Paul and the letters of the other apostles. But here in Matthew 16 and Matthew 18 is the only place in the Gospels that the word church is used. But here Jesus says, "I will build my church." He will build my gathered people. And so it is his church, and it is, as even as we read that passage from 1 Peter, I'll just read it to you again. I have a bookmark to quickly go there. And he says, "You yourselves are living stones being built up as a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ." And so here, you yourselves are living stones being built up as a spiritual house. And again, in that passage in Ephesians, that here we're built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, with Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone. That here we're being built together, stones not like the stones that are holding up this building, not like the stones even as a facade on the front of the building, but stones, living stones, those who are alive, those who are trusting in Jesus Christ, those who are turning towards him, being built together to be the body of Christ, to be his house, to be his church. And really, this is the hard thing for us, is that even as we're being built together and coming together with people that we don't necessarily have any affinity to, besides the fact that we're all trusting in the Lord together, it becomes difficult in the call to serve one another. And really, it's the reminder that God's working in us, that he'd be changing us, that we might serve one another all the more, all better. And yet he's the one that's building us together. And I don't want you to miss that when you have a disagreement over things going on in the church. That here, it's for reasons unknown to me, the Lord has brought us together. And then as we continue on, still in verse 18, "I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." And again, this is a little bit of a difficult text to understand, but I see kind of two aspects of understanding. What does it mean that the gates of hell shall not prevail against it? And the first is that of spiritual attacks. That here, Satan is prowling around like a lion, seeking whom he may devour. And even Jesus, when he talks about Peter, he says, "Satan desired to have you, to sift you like wheat, and yet I have prayed for you that your faith may not fail. And that when you have returned, bless your brothers, encourage your brothers." And isn't this the very prayer that we need, is Jesus Christ's intercession for us? That, yeah, we're weak, we're unable to fight as we should, and Satan is desiring to have us. Satan is desiring to sift us like the wheat. And yet Christ is on our side, and he is building his church, and Satan cannot prevail against that. And that here in physical terms, we do see churches decline. We do see physical powers coming against and even closing churches and even implementing persecution. And if you go to China, they're trying to close down all the unofficial churches again. And you know, here, in physical terms, China's prevailing, at least to some degree. The Communist Party there shutting down all opposition. And yet, here, how do we understand that nothing prevails against it, that the gates of hell do not prevail against the church? Is that we know that Christ's church is more than just the mere physical congregations it's made up of. And that through history, that it's often said that the blood of martyrs who die for their faith is the seed for the church. Is that it's really the greatest testimony for Christ. And that it makes no sense to people. Why should you die for someone who died so long ago? And yet our confession is, he is not dead, but he's risen. How can I not give my life for the one who died in my place? And so here, this is, the world might prevail even physically for a time, but Christ, nothing can prevail against him. And the second understanding that I kind of draw from this is the gates of hell are the entrance into the place of the dead. That this would have been the understanding of the time, is that here, the gates of Hades, and mine has a little note here, rather than hell, the Greek word is Hades. That's the actual word from Greek. And yet this is an understanding of the place of the dead. And, you know, in the Old Testament, the equivalent is Sheol, which is, you know, in the psalmist says, if I go down into Sheol, even you are there. And then if we go even unto death, that cannot prevail against the church of Christ. And that just to read Romans 9, and this reminder that nothing is able to prevail against us. Or Romans 8, verses 31. What shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? If it is God who justifies, who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died, more than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, and who is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress, persecution or famine, or nakedness or danger, or the sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long, and we are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. And I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor present things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of Christ Jesus our Lord. As if you are the Lord's, nothing can separate you from his church. He is the one building it, even to face death itself. And so here, this is our foundation, that we're founded on Christ, and that he is our sureness even to face death in his name. And yet we come to verse 19 here, and he says, I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. So back to Matthew 16, verse 19. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. And so here the keys are representing authority that is given to the church. So the church, when assembled, and yet this is authority given even as a reminder, even as we partook of the Lord's Supper, that while we do not have the power to forgive sins, do not have this power, we have the power even to proclaim the forgiveness of sins. The power to let people know that if you're trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ, if you confess your sins, he is faithful to forgive them, and that you have this assurance that Jesus Christ is your intercessor in heaven. Because here it is, I give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And so here, it is also by God's word that we proclaim the binding of those in sin, that if you refuse to repent and turn away from your sin, you shall perish in it, and you have no place in the book of life. Your name shall be expunged, and only eternal darkness and damnation remains for those who refuse to repent. And yet we have this authority to proclaim, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And this is a solid place to stand, that here, Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father is in who is in heaven. And this is what we proclaim, is that if you are truly trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ, in a way we can't really understand that if you're understanding who he is, it is God that has blessed you with that understanding. And thus we proclaim the blessings of heaven upon those who are trusting in the Lord. And so here we have this proclamation of forgiveness and this assurance to those who are trusting in him. And yet also an authority to organize ourselves, that here when we gather together, that we organize ourselves into a body, into a church, that goes beyond just merely physically being present with one another. We have organized, and I am one of the pastors. Dave is another pastor. We have deacons. We have elected people in all kinds of boards and people doing all kinds of ministry, that it doesn't just, we don't just show up all on Sunday and decide who's going to do what, but we organize and we plan ahead of time, and we have an organization and an authority that's given to us by Christ, that as we gather in his name, that we're called to organize into a church, organize into the visible body of Christ. And so in that, we also have membership in the church, and that would be a whole nother sermon as well. But that here, that individually, we are all part of the body of Christ, his church, and yet individually members of it. And so here, as we conclude, we look at our one foundation. We look at recognizing Jesus Christ as he is. And so this is the only assurance that you need. Are you recognizing Jesus Christ as he is? Do you see him as he is, or are you making him up as you'd like him to be? And then if you are coming to him as he is, that is our foundation. That is our sure place on which we stand. He is the rock on which we stand. And so when we're looking for what is a church, just to kind of answer that question as related to this, well, a true church is a church that has Jesus Christ as its foundation and the confession of him as such, and has no assurance on any man or organization, but only on Jesus Christ as revealed in the Bible to us. So there, where you find a true church. Dear Lord, I pray that you'd be blessing us as we receive your word, helping us to understand it all the more. Even as we close in singing a song, I pray that you'd be working in our hearts. Help us to know that you are God. Help us to turn aside from any other thing that we would trust in or stand on, and rest in your word alone, resting in you as our Savior, as our rock. Amen.
So our final hymn is The Solid Rock. Please stand. My hope is upon nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the Son. Thank you.
Conclude by reading that passage from Psalm 18 again. I love you, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I will call upon the Lord who is worthy to be praised, and I am saved from my enemies. Dear Lord, I pray that to You'd be helping us to trust in You all the more, that in all the shifting sand and everything that's all around us, that we would stand on You as our firm foundation, that we would be a house built on the rock and not on the sand, that when all the troubles and all the toils come of this world, that we would stand firm, not because of strength in ourselves, but because You are the sure place that holds us up. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Oh, yeah. Also, so Soup Sunday in the Foundation Hall. And if you want to drop off your ballots for letting us know what time you prefer service. And there will also be a brief time if you want to ask me any questions after the Soup Sunday. So just to get to know me a little better.